The other day, I came across a Google Photos memory that took me back to my travels to a beautiful, beautiful country called Chile almost 7 years ago. I had a rare chance to visit one of the largest instruments on Earth in the middle of the Atacama Desert called the Paranel Observatory with big ground-based telescopes. Astrophysicists, cosmologists, and scientists all around the world use these telescopes to probe the skies and beyond in the universe. Now, after visiting the insides of these large telescopes, the tour ended with a visit to the control room that looked a lot like this photo, where the operators used computers to control these telescopes and download the data collected. Increasingly, software that is run external to the instrument is being used to not only control the instrument, but also collect the data and process the findings from the data. And that kind of brings me to the famous article that Mark Anderson once wrote in 2011 titled "Software is Eating the World." He pointed out many industries such as booksellers, video services, music companies that are actually software companies. This kind of makes me think about the daily instruments that I typically use in a hardware lab, such as, say, the vernier caliper, the multimeters, or even a logic analyzer. First, obvious way in how the software is changing the world of instrument is via the user interface. And that is residing typically on an external laptop or a mobile. Now, conventionally, instruments have an embedded display with, say, knobs and buttons and even screens to interact with it. For example, an oscilloscope, which is a very, very common hardware lab instrument. But look at the Saleae Logic Analyzer hardware. It is tiny and simple with no complicated buttons or interfaces to deal with. But I'm more excited about Logic 2, which is currently still in the alpha version. I believe this version of Logic 2 is made with web technologies and the team is always updating. So when you first open up Logic 2, this is how it looks like, very crisp and clean design. And currently I am using the version 2.3.5, which is up to date as of August 2020. So after I clear up the interface a little bit, on the left hand side you see all the channels. Now because I'm using Logic 4, it has 4 channels, but of course you're using Logic 8 or Logic 16, you'll have that number of channels. I have 4 digital channels and of course channel 0 is also available as analog. The cool thing about this interface is that I can drag around the channels in any way I like. I can even rename them. Let's say channel 0 is data, channel 1 is clock. I can even resize them. Let's say I resize the digital clock channel and I can match all other digital channels to this height. I can also hide certain channels. Let's say channel 3. Also, let me hide it. And maybe the analog channel, I can make it a little bit wider. On the right-hand side, we will see some buttons here. The very first one is to trigger or start the capture of the signal. The second one is the capture setting. So here you see I have the chosen channels here. The rest two are hidden or disabled. We can also choose the speed at which we want to capture it. The analog channel or the digital channels, the speeds are different. You can capture them. And also how you want to trigger the capture. For me, maybe I'll put it to just timer. And let's say we will put it to just 5 seconds. You can also do it via trigger, which can come in very handy either by rising edge, falling edge, high pulse or low pulse. So I'll set it to timer. So the capture setting is really, really simple. The next is the type of analyzers. Of course, these three, the SPI, the I2C and the async serial are the common ones. But here we can also add in more such analyzers. So after the analyzers, we have the next one, which is measurements or annotations. This is where we can kind of do some analysis on the captured signal. We will explore this a little bit later. And I'm very, very excited about the last one, which is extensions. So here we can actually install other extensions written by the community members. Now these people can be part of the Saleae team, as well as engineers like you and me who can create these extensions and share it with the wider community. So now that we are familiar with the interface and the layout of the software, the next crucial thing is obviously to control and capture the required data. So in our case, we will use a couple of temperature sensors. We will connect it to the logic analyzer via our laptop and capture the signals. The first sensor measures the temperature and humidity, and it is based out of Si7021 temperature sensor. We will use this dev board from Adafruit and connect it to Arduino Uno and get its temperature roughly about every 2 seconds via the I2C protocol. Also keep its datasheet handy to decode the temperature after capturing the signals. So this is how the entire setup looks like. And we have three things: the temperature sensor on the breadboard connected to the microcontroller, and the logic analyzer hooked up to the laptop. Now, it might seem like a lot of wires, so let's look at the schematic to simplify things. Here you see the Arduino Uno microcontroller, and the only thing that we have connected to, of course, other than the power and the ground, are the couple of pins for I2C, the SDA and the SCL. They are connected directly to the sensor. And of course, these are the two lines that we will be probing via the logic analyzer, channel 0 and channel 1. So let's take a peek at the code as well. This is a really like a hello world code for Si7021. In the setup function, we are setting up the serial monitor and just doing a quick check to see the sensor is available. And after that, inside the loop, we are blinking the LED just to denote that we are reading the temperature sensor, which means that we are reading the sensor every 2 seconds. So I'm going to go ahead and upload this firmware onto Arduino Uno, the microcontroller. So I am here on my serial monitor. Let me rescan the ports. And yep, the port is chosen, the baud rate is chosen. So let's connect it and see what the serial monitor says. All right, started temperature in Celsius. It is about 26 degrees Celsius. So here, let's first arrange the channel. So I'm going to put the data channel right at the top, and now we can also rename it. So let's rename it as SDA, and the clock is SCL, and this is the analog one. So I'm just going to widen the channels a little bit and say match digital channels to current height. As for the analyzer, I can choose I2C. Yep, channel 0 is SDA and channel 1 is clock, save. So now that everything is good, let me click the start button to capture the signals. And there is another signal. So looks like we have captured two signals, two temperature signals, and they are about 2 seconds apart, which is exactly what we wrote in the code. So why don't we zoom into one of the I2C signals captured? And there you see, this is how it will look like. So from here, we will have to decode the temperature later on when we write our extension. So next, let's move on to the second temperature and humidity sensor, which is based out of DHT11, a through-hole component. Now, the DHT11 is available as a non-standard one-wire protocol. So there are a few data sheets on the internet, but we got to find the one that explains the signals because we'll be decoding them, especially how the data bit 0 and 1 formats are. So we will also connect this temperature sensor DHT11 to Arduino Uno and get its temperature roughly about 2 seconds. And because it has only one data line, the logic analyzer needs to probe only that line. This is the microcontroller here, of course, connected to the 5 volts and the ground. We have only connected one wire from the D7 pin of Arduino to the data pin of DHT11. And of course, the logic analyzer channel 0 will be probing this data line, and the ground of the logic analyzer is also connected to the common ground. Let's look at the code once again, which is really, really simple. We will define some pins at the start, and in the setup, it's similar. We will begin the sensor, and in the loop, every 2 seconds, we will read the temperature, and in between, we will blink the LED to denote that the temperature is being read. So looks like all the wiring and everything is connected. So why don't we upload this firmware? And yep, it is uploaded. To check that it is uploaded, let's visit the serial monitor. It is giving a temperature of 26.00. It is consistently giving 00 because of the temperature sensor itself and the accuracy of it. And this time we will create a new session in the logic analyzer software, channel 1. We will only need channel 1, channel 0 actually, so it's just the data channel. In terms of capture, yep, it is only digital 0 and analog 0. I will capture it by a predefined duration of 5 seconds. As for the analyzer, I will remove it because it is a non-standard one-wire protocol. And I think that's about it. Let me clear the screen and I will start the capture. All right, seems like it has captured, so let me zoom out and see what has happened. All right, so it has captured actually 3 signals which are 2 seconds apart. So why don't we zoom into one of the temperature captured? It is a one-wire non-standard protocol. So obviously we will need to read the data sheet to figure out what the actual temperature is. So conventionally, I feel instruments typically stop at this stage. They allow you to control and capture the data, and that's about it. In fact, when you start a new measurement, the old data might not be available. And this is where I think having a software that can capture and export the measured or captured data is very valuable. In Saleae, we can export the data in 2 ways. So the first way is the Saleae file format itself. So we will go to File and then Save Capture. And here we can save it on the desktop as a .sal file. So let me name it as Si7021 for the first one. And I will go to the next session and also save the capture. And let me name it as DHT11 on the desktop as well. And now if we visit the files on the desktop, we will see a couple of files which are in the Saleae file format. Now the cool thing is I can simply double click the file and it will come to the Logic Analyzer software and it will open up the exact captured data. Of course, it will say that it is a read-only data and nothing you can do about it. The second way how we can export is simply by exporting the data. And this is really cool in the sense that we can export it in the CSV file format. And now we can use this CSV file format to ingest it via any programming language or even a spreadsheet application. Now, typically, I like to only capture the digital channels because capturing the analog channel will take up a lot of data. But of course, you can do that as well. But I will just uncheck it. This is the DHT11 where I only used channel 0. So I'm going to do that and let's try just the visible screen. So I'm only going to capture the signal here onwards. So let me export it. And there you see, it will export it to a folder on the desktop. And now when I come to the desktop, I'll see a couple more folders here. Let's check them out. DHT11 is a CSV file. And when we open up, of course, we'll see only 2 columns. You see the time is starting from about 2.8 seconds because we are only capturing the visible screen. And here is the data in digital format, 0 or 1. So having a user interface and then being able to control it or even exporting the data, I believe it's becoming much, much more common. But the next 2 points, the next couple of points are what I think are the game changers in terms of having a software control and interface with a hardware instrument. And these game changers are the ability to create extensions or plugins and then distributing them via the community. Now, in a previous video, which I kind of linked up here, I have actually used the data sheet to manually decode the temperature sensor. But for today's video, we are going to write some extensions and use some community extensions from the marketplace to analyze the signals instead of doing it manually. So for the first temperature sensor, which is based out of the I2C protocol, I'll be using something called the high-level analyzer extension that I'll be writing on top of the I2C protocol. So the first step to creating an extension for Saleae Logic Analyzer is to click this button called Extensions. So I'm going to click Create Extension. And yes, I'm going to choose the high-level analyzer based out of I2C and let's give it a title. And let me save that on the desktop. So once we do that, notice in the extension, there'll be something called local. And then, of course, we can publish it, but I won't publish it yet. So now when I open the folder, it will have 3 files. That is basically the boilerplate file. The second one is the Python file. This is where we will be writing our extension. So for the Python file, let me simplify the file a lot by just removing the comments. And for this initialization, I'll simply say just pass. So now you see my Python file, which is basically the crux of our extension, is really, really simple. I'm going to simply, for the sake of simplicity, just call it found, which means I found the stuff I'm looking for. And inside the format, I'll simply say data. And inside decode, why don't we try to find the frame type called data? How do we know which frame type we are looking for? Well, yep, we are looking for the data frame type. And once we find it, then only we will return. And here we will refer to the object name once again, which is found. And nope, we have nothing inside. So this is as simple as it gets, like just a 15-line code. So what I need to do is go to the analyzer, And then I need to add on the analyzer. It is already available, Si7021i2c. And yep, I will choose i2c and let's click finish. And once we do that, look, it has correctly identified the data frames. Now, of course, another type of frame is address. So why don't we replace the data with address and see how it looks like. So I'm going to come here and call it address. And frame type is, address. And yep, the return type will still refer to the found object as the first parameter. So if you want to reload the analyzer, all we need to do is right-click this local analyzer that we created and then reload the source files. And immediately, we will see that address is here. Now, from the temperature sensor data sheet, we know that the temperature can be decoded from these two acknowledged data frames. So we're going to come here and then we're going to add on, say, and data frame is acknowledged. So it has to be data. So I'm going to change back to data. And now when we come back to analyzer, we can reload the source files. And yep, it says data here. So once again, I will refer to the data sheet for Si7021, the I2C section. And yep, here they will say that we will have the most significant byte and the least significant byte. And basically, we have to combine them and use this equation to decode the temperature. So why don't we transfer this equation in the Python code? So to do that, let's start with the return object. Firstly, I will change this to an error correcting or an error detecting frame. And then I will also create a new one called high-level analyzer I2C. And here the format will simply be a dynamic format in this case. It will simply be data.temperature that we will later on create. So now that the result types are done, we will basically have to go frame by frame. So for that, I will create a temporary frame that we can refer as we go on to the next frames. All right, so let me delete everything in the decode function and start fresh. So the first thing that I'm going to do is if the current frame is none, then you just simply return it as error. The next bit, I will be checking for the start frame type. And if it is start, it will simply refer to the return type higher analyzer I2C and then attach the data, which is empty for now. I will also check for the frame type stop and then basically return the new frame. But we are not done yet. What we did are some just checking and finding the start and the stop of the frames. So just like we did before, we are firstly gonna check for the frame type if it is data and also acknowledged. Once we find that, we will then create a variable called data byte and store that. And then we will do some check to say that, hey, if it is longer than zero, then we will start creating or appending the most significant byte and the least significant byte. So MSB in this case will be the previous data and LSB will be the current data and we will have to format it as hexadecimal. And finally, because we are appending it, we will do a little hack and just shift it by 100. Now we saw the temperature sensor code here and we will now start writing this code. So temperature will simply equal to, so for this, I will round up the temperature and put it as a string. And finally, use the temperature and append a degree C to it. And of course, if it is lesser than zero, then the current data is you're just kind of adding on and hexadecimal to data byte. Okay, so this is where we are adding the temperature and we will have the temperature, the value that we calculated from the equation displayed here. So let me reload the source file and there you see it is 26.12 degrees C. And for the final part, now that we have written the extension, the next powerful thing to do is actually to be able to share this extension with the community at large. And I think this is pretty powerful because we might not need to duplicate something if it is already made by someone else. So for this example of showing how we can actually use extensions by the community, we will use back the signals captured by DHT11. And we will go to the marketplace and install some extensions. But here we will not use the analyzer because it is not part of a standard protocol. We will instead use this thing called measurements. Now, from the data sheet, we know that we are supposed to receive about 40 data. And although we will not calculate it manually, let's zoom into this one. Like the 0-bit format is made up of a signal which is 50 plus say about 30 microseconds, and the 1-bit data format is made of signal which is 50 plus 70 microseconds. I'm gonna add again, and I'm gonna choose from where the data should start and somewhere around here. And once we do that, you will notice that they are gonna give you a number. I'm actually not sure what this number is, but let's go to the extensions, install this extension called pulse count, count the number of positive and negative pulses. When we click, it will give us more information. So basically our measurements will have more attributes, NP plus and NP minus. So let me go ahead and install it. And now when we come to the measurement, you see that it will be 40 or 41 thereabouts. So we do know that the data is captured here. The temperature data is captured here as denoted by the data sheet, the output 40 data. As another example, let's try to install this one, the average period. So I'm going to install it and I'm going to add another measurement. And in this case, I'm going to add the ones that we see with the shorter signals. And when I come to the T average, it is actually around 80 microseconds, which is basically similar to the data bit zero, which is 50 plus 30. Which is 80 microseconds. Why don't we do the same with the 1-bit? So it should be 50 plus 70, 120 microseconds. So I'm gonna come and add another measurements. Let me choose the one with the wider signals. And yep, the T average is around 120 microseconds. So by analyzing using these measurements here, we can also probe into the signals. And of course, like I did manually, you can go ahead and decode it 00. To be honest, for many software related instruments, having a plugin and extension and API and sharing it with the community along with, you know, the tools such as controls and displaying the data are not uncommon. For example, as a web developer, a browser dev tool is a typical software instrument, and Chrome and Firefox have extensive add-ons and plugins. Or even software tools such as Figma, which is a design tool, they also have a rich network of community users who are contributing to creating plugins and extensions. But I'm especially excited about the real-world physical instruments such as telescopes, vernier calipers, logic analyzers that are integrating software not only to have a dynamic user interface, but also the ability to create extensions and plugins that can be shared around the community worldwide. Do check out the open source options such as the SigRock project with PulseView as the graphical user interface for instruments like logic analyzers or the oscilloscopes. But does this mean that software is more important than hardware? Well, not really. In fact, I feel it is quite the reverse. As the saying goes by Alan Kay, people who are really serious about software should make their own hardware. So here's to all the instrument engineers out there, whether they are doing the hardware part of it, the software part of it, or even material science and mechanical engineering part of it, that makes our lives as application engineers or other areas of engineering much more delightful, so that we can continue to do our job, we can continue to debug, probe into the data that we collected, or even explore the universe. So, thank you for watching this video, and I'll see you in the next one.